King of Kings and the Lord of Glory himself. You know, in him, the Bible says that all things are passed away and all things are become new. How many of you guys have some old stuff that you want to get rid of, that you want to leave behind, and you want to walk into the newness of God? Well, this morning, that's what you can do in the presence of the Lord. The Bible says that in his presence is freedom, in his presence is joy forevermore. So we invite you to clap your hands, dance and sing with us, and shout unto God with the voice of triumph. It is good to be in his presence, and it's good for you to be with us here. So we're going to worship the Lord together. We are not here to perform. We're not here for a show. We're here for Jesus. And so we welcome you. Follow along using the words that are going to be on your screen and sing with us.
It's always like springtime with you, making all things new. Your light is breaking through the dark.
Alive, you make me come alive, oh, you make
first time. It's like I'm living for the first time. Finally living for the first time. It's like I'm living for the first time. Finally living for the first time.
Worship and to tell you how thankful we are for your goodness to us, Lord. Thank you for pouring out your goodness, your kindness, your love, your mercy, your grace upon us, God, without measure. We're such a blessed people because of you. And we offer up our best praise. We offer up our best offering this morning as we sing to you. You're the only one that's worthy of our praise, God. We just worship you, God. You're so wonderful, so worthy of it all. Thank you, Jesus. Sing your promise.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness.
Good morning, church. I'm Pastor Jake. I'm the lead pastor here at the Ark Christian Church, and it's my honor and my privilege to be able to pray with you this morning. As I was preparing my heart to pray with you today, I just felt like God just dropped this into my heart, that as we head into the holiday season, I felt like there was a dark cloud that was trying to come over a number of people, that you're starting to feel this grayness come in, and it's not just the atmosphere, it's not just the weather, it's not just the clouds that are coming in to bring snow or to bring rain wherever you are in the world. It's not about that. It's about sometimes the holidays are the hardest times for people. And you know, sometimes it's the feeling that families are not going to be together or a loved one is not there with you. But I want to tell you today that God is near to the brokenhearted. I want to tell you today that God wants to bring peace into your heart and into your storm. You know, in the grayness of life, I want to give you this word. The Bible tells us in the book of Psalms that the entrance of your word gives light and gives understanding to the simple. I want to just confirm with you today that, you know, when light comes, color comes to the world. It's light that causes things to shine, and it causes things. There is no such thing as a rainbow without light. And I want to tell you today that God wants the light of God to begin to flood into your world, into your life, into your moment right here and right now. That God wants to come and he wants to bring illumination to your life and to break off that gray, that dark, that heavy cloud. So today, if that's you, I want to just ask you, if you're in a mini church with us here at the Ark, maybe just ask some people to gather around you and lay their hands upon you, because hands are for blessing. If you're with your family, maybe have your family lay their hands on you. If you're with yourself out there today and you're experiencing what I'm talking about, just take your hands, just put them over your heart, and I'm going to stretch my hands toward you as an attitude or an act of faith that God is going to touch you as you lay your hands on yourself. And as I stretch my hands toward you, let God touch you right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, I declare that every dark cloud, every gray and heavy and depressing thing would break off of your people right now in the name of Jesus. That one that might not even know you today, but they're here in this very moment. I pray, God, that you would come and that you would intersect their life right now. I thank you that today is the day of salvation. Lord, I thank you that you've come, that you would set the captive free. Lord, I thank you that you would come and that you would bring color, that you would bring light, that you would bring understanding as the word of God comes and enters their world. Lord, I pray that you would comfort, that you would be near to the brokenhearted, that the comforter would do what only he can do, and that they would feel comfort and that life, that liveliness would come into their life. Every shackle and every bondage and every chain and every heaviness break off now in Jesus' name, and let the life of God come and fill you in this very moment in Jesus' name. Now today in this church, we believe that Jesus Christ is alive. We believe that not only is he alive, he is still doing the same things today that he did as he walked this earth in a physical body. But he's doing it through his people, his disciples. And God wants you to be healed, to be whole, to be set free in your life. If you're experiencing sickness, disease, hurt, pain, mental illness, spiritual affliction, if you've been crushed, maybe in your heart, maybe in your life, you've experienced chronic sickness over and over and over again. No one else around you gets sick, but somehow you are always sick. That is not by coincidence. That is a spiritual design and attack on you. And Jesus has come to destroy the works of the devil in our lives. He's come to set us free. And it should be abnormal for you to be sick. It should be abnormal for you to have any symptoms in your life. And it's not any kind of condemnation on you. I want to tell you that, because it is the truth that makes us free. Jesus said, you will know the truth and the truth will make you free. He wants you to know that he died so that you could be made free, so you could be whole, so that you could be healthy in your spirit, your soul, and in your body. Today, if you need a healing touch from heaven, would you just extend your faith right now as I pray for you to receive that touch from heaven? You don't have to do anything to earn it or to deserve it. You might have done everything to deserve what you have, but Jesus has great grace and mercy for you. and for me. So today I want to declare the mercy and the grace of Almighty God over you and let healing come into your body. As I pray, if you've got pain in your physical body right now, just go ahead and check your body over again as I pray, because you might just find that you are completely healed or you're significantly better because the presence of God is coming and touching you in a tangible way right now. If that's you, go ahead and exert your faith by moving your body. Feel your body and experience the healing power of God. Father, in the name of Jesus, right now for anyone that might be suffering in their spirit, in their soul, or in their body with disease, with chronic illness, with a terminal diagnosis, with something that is gripping their heart with fear, Father, in the name of Jesus, I declare the healing power of the risen King upon them. Jesus, you are alive and you are doing what you did while you were on the earth, healing every sickness and every disease and setting the captive free. We declare over your people today, God, that the mercy of the Lord would come in, that the grace of God would be at their side, and that they would be healed. Let every trace of pain, let every trace of sickness, let every trace of disease, of mental illness, of addiction, and of struggle in that way be broken off of your people in the name of Jesus. We declare today is the day that they are free indeed. Lord, we thank you for it. We believe you today in Jesus' name. Now today I want to just ask you, if you would make sure, go ahead and check your body, palpate yourself. If you had a growth or something that you could feel before, go into the restroom or something, go check and see if you're healed, because God is doing miracles every single day and every single week. If you've been healed, if you know that you've been healed in your body or in your mind or in your emotions, we want to ask if you would just let us know so we can rejoice with you. You can just drop it into the comment stream or message us, call us, email us. Let us know Jesus has healed me, because he's still the healer today. As we go back into a time of worship, would you just begin to thank him for your healing? Thank him for making you free. Thank him for the day of salvation that has come to visit your house today. Come on, let's worship God together.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, and this is my confidence. You've never failed. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness.
Faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your
Use us, Lord Jesus, for your glory.
When you walk into the room, everything changes. Darkness starts to tremble at the light that you bring. When you walk into the room, every heart starts burning, and nothing matters more than just to sit here at your feet and worship you. We love you, and we'll never stop. We can't live without you, Jesus. We love you, and we can't get enough. All this is for you. We want you. Come and consume God, all we are. We give you permission, our hearts are yours. We want you. We want you. We want you.
lift up your hands in this place right now. Wherever you're at, whatever you're doing, I want you to stop what you're doing and give your attention to Jesus. Lift your hands and just worship Him. Come on, it's the best thing that you can do with what He's given to you. Give Him your heart, give Him your hands, give Him your body, give Him your love. Jesus, we love You in this place. God, we just lift up Your name. We worship Your name. We worship You, God. You're worthy of everything that we have to offer, all our thanks, all our praise. We love You, Jesus. All of this is for You. Wonderful as You are. No one we love more than You. No one who loves us more than You, Jesus. To You we sing our praise. To You we give our worship. Come on, we give You worship. Receiving that as our praise has gone up, Lord, we pray that your rain would come on us, Lord Jesus, that it would be evident that we are mindful of You, mindful of Your presence. It would be evident that we're lovers of our God and that His favor is upon us, that His grace is upon us without measure. Lord, thank you for pouring out your Spirit upon us, Lord Jesus, that we can be examples to those that witness our lives, those that hear us say how wonderful our God is, how awesome he is to us, how much he's blessed us. It's because of your love that we are alive. It's because of your love that we're here to be demonstrations to the people that you've created who have not yet heard of your love yet. Come and consume us, God. All we are, we give you permission. Our hearts are yours. We want you. We want more of your presence. We want more of you, God, so that we can be the shining bright lights that you've called us to be in this world. Thank you for that privilege. Thank you for that honor to serve you and to give our lives back to you this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Woo. I pray that with every breath that you sang, every breath that you prayed, every breath that you declared in your own prayers to God this morning, that you gave him glory and honor, and that you sense his amazing love for you right now, and that you allow him to just wrap you up in his arms. You're so blessed this morning to be in his presence. I'm so blessed to be in his presence with people who are lovers of God. Don't go anywhere. We're going to be right back. Someone is going to come and they're going to preach the word of God with boldness and with power. And I'll give you a sneak peek. It's none other than one of our very own founding pastors, the one who began and was a pilgrim to start this church. And we're so grateful and blessed to have them come and share a word to be a blessing to you this morning. We're going to be right back after we switch a couple of things. Don't go anywhere. You don't want to miss a thing, because God is going to do some good things. We're going to be right back.
Well, good morning, everyone. I'm Pastor Russ, and I get a privilege today to share with you about the abundance of God. And I'm gonna approach it from a different place and a different perspective than maybe what you're used to. But I think it's really important at this time of year to talk about this. And if you can go ahead and put up the title for my message, that would be great. So our abundance is in his presence. Amen. That's what we're talking about. Today, if you didn't sense the presence of God and you were worshiping you need help. Yeah, you need help. You need prayer, because that the presence of God was really great this morning. And I want to approach this. We're going to look at Exodus chapter 33, but I want to just preface it real quick. And we're going to be using the English Standard Version. English Standard Version. And I'm going to put it up. We're going to read all the way through this chapter, and then I'm going to stop in certain places and just explain a couple things. And I think you'll understand what this chapter means to us today. Now, this happened several thousand years ago, but everything happened, and God put these things down and told us this story because he wanted to teach us something. You know, how many of you have ever gone to Disneyland with your family? You know, my son, Pastor Jake, and his family are going to go to Disneyland sometime, and they're going to go to Disney World for the first time. But now, I want you to just imagine this. If they were all going to go, and they were all excited, and Pastor Jake said to his family, you know, you guys go, but I'm not going to go with you. But you know, I'll send someone though that to represent myself, and they'll go with you. How do you think the family would feel? Would it be the same thing? So no, if you don't go with us, we don't want to go, right? And so this is what this story is about here. This is Moses talking to God, and God talking to Moses and discussing a situation. What had happened prior to this conversation is that the people of Israel, Moses went up into the mountain, and God gave him a download of the laws and his Ten Commandments and all of that. That was the first time the internet was created. You know, God spoke out of the cloud and onto a tablet, you know. So this was the internet, the beginning of the internet. And then, so Moses wrote these things down, and he came down with the blessing of God in his arms. And when he came down to the base of the mountain, what he saw was not a bunch of people who were anticipating what God said to them, but he saw a bunch of people worshiping a golden calf. And he took the tablets and he broke them, because he didn't want the word of God and the blessings of God to be tarnished because of the sin of the people. Now, what was the sin of the people? It was worshiping the calf, but it wasn't so much that it was a calf as much as it was, I believe, made of gold. It was their gold. They put their riches, they put their value into an object, and they worshiped their money. They were worshiping gold. And how many times do we hear about it that, you know, people are worshiping their money, worshiping their finances? And even more so, how many times does God say to us and ask us the question, who are you worshiping? You know, when the offering time comes around, who are you asking about how much to give? Are you asking your bank account, or are you asking the Lord? You know, are you worshiping your finances, or are you worshiping God? And sometimes it gets really cloudy as far as what we can see. So this is what comes in to us, the situation when the Lord commands Moses and the people to leave Sinai. Now, when they go to when they're leaving Sinai, they're going to head toward the Promised Land, and there are giants there, and they're going to have to fight battles. Now, when you fight battles, you want the big guy on your side, right? So let's just read through this and see what he says. It says, the Lord said to Moses, depart, go up from here, you and the people whom you have brought out of Egypt, out of the land of Egypt, to the land of which I swore to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, saying, to your offspring will I give it. Now the people were his offspring. And he says, I will send an angel before you. You're going to send what? Send an angel before you. And I will drive out the Canaanites and the Amorites and the Hittites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites and the Termites. Oh, that's in there. He says, but go up to a land flowing with milk and honey. He's saying, you're going to be blessed. go. He says, but I will not go up among you. What? He said, I'm going to send an angel, a representative. You'll have power. You'll have blessing, but I'm not going to go with you. And, you know, it's like, how come? He says, because if I go up with you, lest I consume you on the way, because you're a stiff-necked people. Stiff-necked means that they wouldn't listen. They were determined to worship their gold. They were determined. They destroyed the calf, but they were still determined. Somehow they were going to worship a different god than the true God. And when the people heard this disastrous word, they mourned, and they should have. And no one put on his ornaments, for the Lord had said to Moses, say to the people of Israel. See, God didn't even talk to the people. He talked to Moses, and he said, you go tell the people, say to the people of Israel, you are a stiff-necked people. If for a single moment I should go up among you, I would consume you. You know, and the reason God said that is because the people, if you read it in other versions, it was the people who said that they were afraid that God would destroy them if he came into their midst. They didn't trust God. They thought, well, you know, he's a mean God. We should be afraid of him. If we make one wrong move, he's going to squash us. And so they didn't trust him, and that's why God said, well, you're a stiff-necked, unbelieving people. You don't even trust me. Can you imagine that if my grandchildren said, Dad, we don't want you to come to Disney World with us because we don't trust you. You know, you're not gonna take care of us. In fact, you might do something to hurt us, you know? Isn't that nuts? But that's what they said about God. And you know, that's what people say about God today. I don't know, you know, what I think God might, you know, be angry at me, and he's gonna destroy me along the way. And you know what, when people's heart says that, like the people of Israel, God said, you know, if I come down there, I'm gonna destroy you. You know, because that's what you're expecting. You know, you don't trust me, well, that's what you're gonna get. So he says, you're a stiff-necked people. If for a single moment I should go up among you, I would consume you. So now, take off your ornaments, that I may know what to do with you. Therefore, the people of Israel stripped themselves of their ornaments from Mount Horeb onward. Now Moses used to take the tent and pitch it outside the camp, far from the camp, and he called it the tent of meeting. So God wanted to be in the middle of their camp, and they were supposed to set up camp around the temple, the tabernacle of Moses. But Moses took it outside the camp because God said, I don't want to be there. I'm going to destroy these people. So can you imagine coming to church and God not here? How would that be? Or, you know, going anywhere and God's not there. How about in your home? What if, you know, your home, you got the Bible, you got your music and everything, but God's not there. That would be horrible. And everyone who sought the Lord would go out to the tent of meeting, which was outside the camp. Whenever Moses went out to the tent, all the people would rise up, and each would stand at his tent door and watch Moses until he had gone into the tent. When Moses entered the tent, the pillar of cloud would descend and stand at the entrance of the tent, and the Lord would speak with Moses. He didn't speak with the people. And when all the people saw the pillar of cloud standing at the entrance of the tent, all the people would rise up and worship, each at his tent door. Thus the Lord used to speak to Moses face to face, as a man speaks to his friend. See, Moses had a relationship with God. Talk to him face to face. That's how our relationship should be, talking to him face to face. And when Moses turned again unto the camp, his assistant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, would not depart from the tent. Moses said to the Lord, see, you say to me, bring up this people, but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. So Moses is saying, you know, we don't want no angel to go with us. He says, yet you have said, I know you by name, and you have also found favor in my sight. Now, therefore, if I have found favor in your sight, please show me now your ways, that I may know you in order to find favor in your sight. You know, how many times do we ask God, what do I need to do, Lord, to find favor in your sight? What do you want me to do? And he said, my presence will go with you. He didn't say with everybody. He says, I'll go with you, and I will give you rest. And he said to him, if your presence will not go with me, do not bring us up from here. He says, for how shall it be known that I have found favor in your sight, I and your people? Is it not in your going with us? So Moses is now pleading for the people. If you don't go with us so that we are distinct, I and your people, from every other people on the face of the earth. See, what makes a Christian different? What makes your home, what makes your finances, your job different from people that don't know God? The only thing that makes a difference is if God is with you. If God's not with you, you're just like the rest. You're just like them. And God said he's going to destroy them. So why do we want to be like them? And the Lord said to Moses, this very thing that you have spoken, I will do. Aren't you glad that you have people praying for you? So that even when we make mistakes and we mess up and we walk away from the presence of God, we have people praying for us. God, don't leave them. Don't leave them. Mm-hmm. This very thing have I spoken to you, I will do, for you have found favor in my sight. And I know you by name. Moses said, please show me your glory. Now that word glory means your riches. Show me your wealth. Show me how much finances you have, God, because I need encouragement. And sometimes we need that. We need that encouragement of God. Show me, Lord, you know, what is available if I'm in your presence. See, the people couldn't see that. They didn't understand that. And so they missed out. But Moses said, show me, you know. And sometimes we're in a church like this where the ministry are praying for us. They are praying for us to be financially well and physically well and everything. And we think because God is blessing us that we must be okay. But sometimes it was like Moses. Moses, the people were okay because Moses was praying for them. Moses was interceding, but the people themselves were still far away from God. And it's not good enough to have the ministry. It's not good enough that you're in a church that you feel good. You need to be in a place, and I need to be in a place of where God's presence is there. Not the presence of the angel giving us power, giving us finances, giving us blessing, because those aren't a sign that God is on our side. What's the only sign is if God's presence is there. God's presence. It says, and I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. So he blesses people that don't deserve it, in other words. It's all up to him. And sometimes we get blessed when we don't deserve it, and we think we're doing okay when we're not. But he said, you cannot see my face, for man shall not see me and live. And the Lord said, behold, there is a place by me. There is a place by me where you shall stand on the rock. And while my glory and all my riches, all my blessings, all my finances, all of the wealth of heaven passes by, I will put you in a place, a cleft in the rock, and I will cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will take away my hand, and you shall see my back, but my face shall not be seen. You know, today as we come and bring our tithes and offerings, are you bringing it because it's the law? Are you bringing it because, you just feel like you have to? Or are you bringing it because you know that the presence of God will follow your obedience? If you want the presence of God, this is part of it. The abundance of God is not what separates us from the world. It's the presence of God. So as we come today, let's come asking God for his presence. And let's come not worshiping what we're bringing and thinking that we're doing God a favor with it, but let's come because we have already been blessed and that we want the presence of God even greater in our lives. You know, Pastor Jake, go with your kids. Go with your family. They don't want to go without you. And we don't want to go anywhere without God. Not in this church. Let's just believe for that. So there's three ways that we can give. You can give on your mobile devices, and text the amount that you would want to give to that number that is right on the screen there. You can also give online by visiting thearccc.com and just tapping on give and following the instructions there. Or you can give in the classic way of cash, check, or credit card, and just fill in the information that you have there, and that will get to us as well. So we're just going to take a few minutes and about a minute and a half and let you fill out your offering and your giving. Ask God, say, what do you want me to do so that I can be in your presence as I'm giving? What do you want me to do? Go ahead and give now, and we'll be right back. Well, I hope all of you actually did pray and ask God, what do you want me to do to please you in my giving today? Let's just pray over the offerings, your offerings and your tithes to the Lord. And I'm going to ask God to just bless you according to the faith that you've put into that offering. Lord, bless the offering of the people. Bless the people that have given to you, Lord, that have loved you more than they love their stuff. Lord, because you love us more than you love your stuff. That's why you gave all of your stuff to us through Jesus Christ. Father, and I bless them now. Bless the finances in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, just hold on now just a minute because real quick, just a minute from now, stay tuned, and we're going to have a message straight from the heart of God from our beloved pastor, my favorite son, Pastor Jake.
Well, hey, everybody, I hope that you've been having a great time in the presence of God so far. You know, if you don't like being in church, I feel so sorry for you because I just love being in church. I love being in the presence of God. I love being with the people of God. I love just being in the presence of the Almighty One. And you know what? One of the favorite things that I have about being in church is simply this, that anything is liable to happen when the presence of God is there. And I want to be just like Moses, like, if you're not going to go with me, God, I don't want to go at all. So you're going to have to go with me, and then we're going to be all right. Well, today, we would just want to welcome you further into the presence of God. Don't stop where you are, but keep on going. You know, if you stop at the gates, you'll never get into the courts. And if you never go past the courts, you'll never get to the footstool. You know, if you go into the tabernacle of God, if you don't get through the way, you don't get to the truth, you don't get to the life. And you've got to get to the presence of God at the holiest place all the way on the inside. And so I hope that you'll come with us as we travel into the Word of God. And you know what's exciting about the Word of God to me is that the Bible says that God follows the preaching of His Word with signs following. So we're believing God that signs are going to follow the preaching of His Word in your life, in your family, in your ministry, in your world, and that God is going to intersect you today. I hope you guys are ready. We're going to dig into the Word of God. You should take notes with us, by the way. If you don't know where to find notes, you can go to our website at www.thearkcc.com, and you can click on the messages tab there, and you can get to the messages. You can download the notes in PDF format, and you can print them out or do them on a PDF thing. If you've got a PDF editor on your mobile device or whatever, you can do that. Or you should just go and download our free app on Google Play or the Apple App Store. You can download our app, and it is the information central for this church. But you can also tap on the thing that says notes right there. You can fill them right there in on your app, and then you can email them to yourself, or you can save them as notes. You can export them to a file so that you can have them for, guess what? Connect group. That's right. You want to take them to your connect group, because that is the place where you get connected, where you can develop deep, authentic, lasting relationships, have a ministry expression, and make sure that your felt needs get met. So make sure that you go to a connect group. You can find those, guess where? That's right, right there on our app. So I hope that you're ready to take notes with us. Better to have a short pencil than a long memory, as my friend says. So buckle your Holy Ghost seatbelts, and here we go. We're going to dive into the Word of God. You guys ready? We're still talking about the new era, but today we're talking about healing the sick. Well, I hope that that excites you in some way. Maybe it terrifies you, but I find that terror and excitement go hand in hand. I'm one of those people that the bigger, the badder, the nastier, the roller coaster, the more I enjoy it, you know? And so I'm just kind of one of those thrill seekers, and maybe that's what I love about God, is that no matter where you are, the just shall live by faith. And faith is an exciting life. You know why? Because you can't see it, but you know that it's there. It is the evidence of things not seen. It is the substance of things hoped for. And when you're so far out there leaning on God, believing Him for big things, and you know that the only way that anything is possibly going to happen is if God comes through, man, that is an exciting life to live, and I wouldn't want to have it any other way. I don't want no broke down, nasty, boring Christian life. I want to have an exciting Christian life. And one of the most exciting things for me is to see God move in my life and in the lives of the people around me. So let me ask you this question. If there was a really good chance that you could help people around you to get healed, how many of you would be willing to take that ability and use it to bless people in your day-to-day life? I mean, I would. I'd do that. There's a lot of people that would. There's people that are in the medical field just simply for that reason, because they know that they can help people get healed. But you know what? There's another way, and His name is Jesus. You know, last week we looked at the biblical case for healing, and so we're going to take that and build on that foundation. Now, today I'm going to be teaching a little more than preaching, but it's still going to be interesting, and it's still going to engage you. In fact, you're going to learn something that is so practical for your life, it's going to bless you. So this week we're going to talk about, and we're going to be going through the Bible and letting the Bible talk to us about how every one of us can minister to the sick and see them recover. Now, I want you to say this with me, because declaring things is important. I want you to say this with me. God created me to be Jesus with skin on to the world around me. You know what? That's exactly what God did. He created you to be Jesus with skin on to the world around you. In other words, Jesus is not here walking around on the earth today. The Bible tells us that Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father. But you know what? He put His Spirit on the inside of you. He took his faith and gave it to you. He took his mind and he put it on the inside of you if you let him. And that means that we are Jesus with skin on, walking around in the world around us. Now, don't think that I'm speaking blasphemy. Jesus put himself in us to multiply himself in the world. And I think it is an amazing thing that he would trust us to be his disciples and to walk as he walked on this earth. You know, if you've ever wondered what was it that Jesus exactly did on this earth, you know what? He didn't do all kinds of crazy things in the sense that he didn't have this ministry and that ministry and this ministry and that ministry. Jesus did three things while he was on the earth. Yep. The Bible tells us this is what he did. In Matthew chapter 9, verse 35, it says this, "Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages," listen to this, "teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people." That's all that Jesus did. He went about teaching, preaching, and healing. Now, what you're going to find if you are a part of the Ark Christian Church, or if you're thinking about being a part of this church, or if you're around us for any length of time, we try to keep it pretty simple. Right? It's that old principle, K-I-S-S, keep it simple, stupid, right? I don't want to have to mess it up, so I'm going to keep it simple. If I can do what Jesus did, I think I'll be doing pretty good, right? All he did was three things, teaching, preaching, and healing. If I can do those three things, I'm pretty satisfied with living a pretty radical Christian life. But I love how the Bible says that Jesus healed every sickness and every disease among the people. Man, that is so exciting. Think about it. If you could be the cure for cancer, if you could be the cure for AIDS, if you could be the cure for COVID-19, if you could be the cure, not a cure, not an injection, but you are the injection for the world of Jesus Christ. Man, that's exciting. You know what? You know, some people are just like, well, you know, if Jesus wants me healed, Jesus knows where I live. But the only problem is he ain't knocking on your door, is he? He's knocking on the door of your heart, though. And you know what? Jesus literally personally knows where every person who needs healing is. But here's the thing. He's sending you and he's sending me to those people. He's not going himself. He's going himself through you and through me. Jesus knows where they live, but he's sending us. Can I hear an amen to that? You know, in Luke chapter 10, verses 1 and 2, in the New King James Version of the Bible, it says this, "After these things, the Lord appointed 70 others also and sent them two by two before his face into every city and every place," listen to this, "that he himself was about to go." So when we go, in other words, when he sends us, he's coming after us. He's not just leaving us out there on our own, leaving us out there to dry. Jesus is coming after us. Signs follow the preaching of his word, and Jesus is coming after us. Verse 2, "Then he said to them, truly, the harvest is great, but the laborers are few. Pray, therefore, the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." You know, that word, that phrase, send out, is actually a really nice way of saying eject. God wants us to pray that he would eject laborers into the harvest field. You know, I pray that whatever seat that you're sitting in today, whether it's a lazy boy recliner or one of the black chairs that are sitting in our sanctuary here today, I pray that that chair turns into an ejection seat for you today and that you get ejected into the harvest field. My goodness, your life is about to get really exciting when you do this one word, which is go. God wants us to go. You know, just a few verses later, Jesus said this, "Whatever city you enter and they receive you, eat whatever is set before you." By the way, I want to tell you that I live this verse. When I go anywhere in the world, I don't even ask what it is. What they set in front of me, I eat it. And I have eaten some things. I've got videos of me eating palm grubs, and they brought them to me live and wriggling before I preached that day. And they're like, oh, you want to try this? They're so wonderful. And I'm so thankful that they roasted them up for me. But I did eat it, and I've eaten red ant chutney. I mean, I've eaten pig brains. I've eaten all kinds of things that have been set before me because I don't turn it down when I am preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. You're going to eat the things that are set before you. Man, I wish I had time to tell you the miracles that God does when you step out there on the mission field about ready to preach the gospel, because my wife has eaten some things that were killing me when it comes to spice, and she does not eat spicy. But God did a miracle for her that she could eat spicy, and she's like, oh, this is not that bad, and I'm over there sweating, and I'm the one that likes spicy. But God does miracles for people when they decide to give in to His word. Eat the things that are set before you. By the way, parents, this is a good verse for you to practice with your kids. You know, sometimes we would do this. I would make some spicy things at home, you know, for a dinner or whatever. And I would tell my kids, guess what we're doing tonight? We're doing missionary training. And if you don't like the food that's set before you, we just called it missionary training. Get used to eating what is set before you. I love it. And then it says, so eat the things that are set before you and heal the sick there and say to them, the kingdom of God has come near to you. You know what the sign is that the kingdom of heaven has come near to people? They get healed. I want the kingdom of heaven to be near to me, so I'm just walking in health all the time. Can I hear an amen? Amen. You know, I want you to know that we are ambassadors of Jesus Christ. We are ambassadors of Jesus Christ. You know what an ambassador is? An ambassador for a nation or for a person or for a company or for an entity. Ambassadors are empowered with delegated authority to represent the one sending them. So when we know that we are ambassadors of Christ, what that means is that we are empowered by heaven with delegated authority to represent Jesus himself. Wherever we go, Jesus is coming after us. You can find this reference in 2 Corinthians 5:20. It says this, now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, the anointed one, and his anointing is what that means. As though God were pleading through us. Can you imagine that? God himself pleading with people through your mouth, through your life, through your hands, through your presence. When you walk into the room, then God comes with you, and God is pleading and working right through you. Amen. We beg you, or we implore you on Christ's behalf, to be reconciled to God. You know, that's what the ambassador of heaven is doing. They're going out and they're saying, I'm begging you to be reconciled to God. I'm begging you to come into the love of Jesus Christ that surpasses the love of anybody else in this planet. We need to understand that God loves people. All right, so here's the thing. Maybe you're getting all hyped up and you're like, Pastor Jake, I'm so excited. I want to do what you're doing. I want to be like you're being, or I want to surpass you. I hope that you surpass me in life and in ministry. And you know what? I pray that you bring healing and restoration and miracles to the world around you. I pray that we would all do that, because think about it. If there were 200 people or 2,000 people or 20,000 people in this church and everybody goes out each day and gets a healing, gets a miracle to take place, that's 20,000 miracles a day. That's 2,000 miracles a day. That's 200 miracles a day. If we would just go out, and it's just one reaching one. But you know what we're going to need? Because I bet you I know what's going to happen. The next thing is that you're like, yes, I'm going to do it. You know, just like when I went up in the airplane to go and jump out of a perfectly good airplane in skydiving. And you're like, yeah, I'm so excited. I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. And then you're up there at whatever it is, 10,000 feet. And they open up the door. And you're like, oh, this just got really real. I don't know if I'm ready for this. I'm not sure whether or not I'm ready to do this. But the good thing about the first time that you ever go skydiving, you know what the good thing is? You must jump tandem. You know what that means? That means the person that's jumped out of that door a lot of times is strapped onto you. And they don't let you sit there on the bench. They push you out the airplane and then deploy the parachute for the both of you. Because otherwise, some people would choose to stay inside of the door. And the worst thing that could happen is you kind of think that you're going to jump out the plane, but then you change your mind halfway out. You can't live life like that. We can't live life halfway in and halfway out. You either jump or you don't. And I pray that you jump today. We need boldness to minister is what I want to tell you. We cannot live in the shadows. We can't live in the background. We can't live weeny little Christian lives. We're not meant to be weeny. We are meant to be mighty in the presence of God. Amen. I love it that Proverbs 28 verse 1 tells us this. It tells us that the wicked flees when no one pursues, but the righteous are as bold as a lion. Oh, I love that scripture. Lions are bold. They don't have anything to fear. I mean, they are just bold. They walk around like they are the boss of the place because they are the boss of the place. They're bold. And you know what? I know that so many people love joking around with this scripture, myself included. This is why I don't go jogging. Because only the wicked flee when no one pursues. So I don't just go jogging. If I'm going to run, I'm running for a reason. If you see me running, you should probably be running too. I'm running from something, all right? So I love the fact that the Bible tells us that the wicked flee when no one pursues, but the righteous are bold as a lion. So here's the answer to boldness that we need. We need to have righteousness. But listen, I want to tell you that, sorry guys, I jumped ahead on you there real quick, but here's the thing. We aren't created to run from sickness and from problems. We are called to boldly run towards it with supernatural help and relief. Let me say that again. You are not meant to run from sickness and disease and problems. You are designed by heaven and called to boldly run towards it with supernatural help and relief. Someone else might not be able to help them, but you can help them. You know why? Because your help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Amen? You see, we receive boldness from receiving righteousness. We need the righteousness of God to dwell in us. When we're righteous, we're bold. See, the wicked flee when no one pursues, but the righteous, no. We don't run. We don't tuck tail and run. We are bold as a lion, and we run towards the problem, not from the problem. So what is this whole righteousness thing? See, because we receive boldness, or we get boldness from receiving righteousness. What is righteousness? Righteousness is the position of right standing with God. When you know that everything between you and God is good, you can look him boldly in the eyes and you're going to be all right. You know, you ever been around somebody where you and them have like, I don't know, a thing? Like there's an offense or there's a problem or maybe there's a rumor or some kind of bad blood or something like that. Some people are experiencing that even around the holiday season. Like there's some family parties you just can't even go to or someone else will never come to because there's something there. And you're trying to talk to somebody, but they can't look you in the eye because there's something there. That's not what God wants for us. In fact, Pastor Stewart preached about it. I'm so glad that he did. That God talked with Moses like he talked with a friend. That he talked to him face to face. That he talked to him just like that. And that's what God desires for us. It's not because that's what Moses wanted. That's what God wanted. God wants us to be able to have nothing in between him and us so that we can talk to him. And what that thing is it's righteousness that produces boldness so we can stand in the presence of God unashamed. You know, that's how it was in the beginning in the garden with Adam and Eve. They were naked and they were unashamed. In other words, not just because they were good looking, because I'm pretty sure they were good looking, right? They weren't eating all the stuff that would make them naked and ashamed. So they were naked and unashamed. They were probably good looking, but it wasn't that. It was that they could be completely exposed in the presence of God and have nothing to hide. You know, in our hearts and in our minds, in our spirits, that's how we ought to be able to be, is we should be able to be completely and totally exposed before God and unashamed. And the only way that we can do that is through this thing called righteousness. Righteousness is the position of right standing with God. And see, that right standing is what gives us boldness with God. In 2 Corinthians 5:21, I love how the Bible says this and gives this to us to hold on to. It says this, "For he made him," so God made Jesus, "who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him." Some of you have heard me use this analogy before, but I used to play volleyball, and one of the things that we had to do was when we would do a substitution, we would have to get to the 10-foot line or the 3-meter line there, and we would have to stand one person on the inside of the court, the other person on the outside of the court, and we would have to touch hands, and we would have to say something like, "Number 7 substituting for number 10. And I would walk into the game or walk out of the game, whichever it was at that time, but we were making a substitution. It was the same position that we were taking. You see, Jesus was our substitute. This scripture right here is a scripture of great substitution, that Jesus became sin so we could become the righteousness of God in him. It was a direct trade. We didn't still have leftover sin. The amount of sin that Jesus had in his life was the amount that he gave to us, which was exactly zero. And all the sin that we had in life that would take us to hell and that would separate us from God, we gave that to Jesus because he became sin for us who knew no sin, that we could become the righteousness of God in him. See, it was this substitution, and I pray that when you substitute and when you receive that substitution, Jesus substituting for Jake, that what you do is you don't hold on to anything of sin and from the past, but you allow that perfect substitution take place so that you can become the righteousness of God in him. And what that allows you to do is stand boldly in the presence of God because you've got no sin, you're totally exposed and totally righteous in God's presence. Listen, we get Jesus' righteousness by receiving Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. You know, when you get into God's presence, when you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, see, a lot of people don't understand how wonderful, how complete, how powerful salvation is. They think that all it is taking all their rubbish and their life and the ruins of their life, and they're just adding Jesus to the rubble. But that's not what salvation is. Salvation is taking our broken down, beat down, busted up, sin-filled life and exchanging it for a brand new, no problems, no sin, no sickness, no disease, no offense between us and God life. And we substitute it with Jesus. We just trade him. You know, it's kind of like when you order something that you didn't like at dinner, and then your spouse or your friend or whatever ordered something that looks really good, and you're just like, you just trade it. And they can have the junk one and you can have the good one. That's exactly what Jesus did. He's like, give me your old broke down nasty life and I'm going to give you my perfect life. And it's a free trade. It's a good trade. I'll take that trade every day of the week and twice on Sundays, my friend. I'm telling you, it is the best trade that you can ever make. See, we get Jesus' righteousness by receiving Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior and trading lives with him. Here's the result. The result is found in 1 John chapter 5 and verse 14. It says this, "And now this is the confidence." Wait, I love that word, the confidence. You know, when people have confidence, they look like this. They look bold. They stand upright. They've got their chest out, and they can look you in the eye when they've got confidence. When someone doesn't have confidence and they have this thing called shame, or they have this thing that is, sin that's on them, or if they're weighted and burdened and heavy laden by the things that they've done, and they're afraid that you're going to find out their past, their whole demeanor, their whole posture changes. And they're like this. You know, I don't know, for those of you that have kids, I don't know if you've ever had your child do something that in their heart, it convicted their heart and their conscience was wrong. And when they came up to you, they couldn't even look you in the eye. And they're just like, and it's on them, and their shoulders are rolled forward, and they're just, their head is down, and you're like, hey, look at me, look at me. Look me in the eyes, and they just can't do it, and they just, You know, so many times when we come to God, that's how we feel. And we identify with the psalmist saying, I'm a worm, but God doesn't want you to be a worm. God wants you to be the son of God. He wants you to be the daughter of the Most High God. That when you walk into his presence with ultimate righteousness, you have this confidence. And you don't have confidence in yourself. Listen, we have this confidence, or this is the confidence that we have in him. That's why we stay in Jesus. That's why we stay in the anointing. That's why we stay in his presence. That's why we stay in his righteousness, because that breeds confidence. This is the confidence that we have in him, that, listen, if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. Wow, I love that word, anything. If we ask anything, anything in his will, he hears us. Wow. Why does he hear us? Why does he hear anything that we ask according to his will? Well, that's because we have right standing with God through Jesus Christ. And we can ask anything according to his will. See, because it's just like it's Jesus standing in front of God himself. That substitution, when we became the righteousness of God in him, when we stand in front of Jesus, who stand in front of God, you know what God sees? God sees Jesus. We made that substitution. And Jesus can ask anything from God. By the way, anything includes healing, because healing is the will of God. You know, by the way, I just want you to know that his will is found written out in his word. This is why we're so strong on telling you, you need to read your Bible. God wrote out his will and testament in the Bible. And when you know what's in it, you can have it. And when you see it, you can ask for it. And when you see it, you can have it, because you have this confidence in him to ask anything that's in his word. I'm so glad that God wrote it all out for me, because I don't know that I always know what God would do. I hear people saying this stuff all the time. You know, if I was God, I would. Well, that's why you're not God, because you would have done something exactly what God wouldn't do. So what we want to find out is, what would God do? The way to find that out is by going to his word, so you can know his will, so you can have ask anything that's in there. Anything that God says he'll do, you can ask him for it, and he'll say yes and amen. I want to give you some important biblical statements about healing. Now, in this section of this message today, I'm just going to give you some things that's going to help you to understand your abilities, your capabilities, your access, what you can do according to God's will and according to God's word. I want to give you some things that are also going to be, that will help you to overcome obstacles to healing. So I'm going to give you scriptural references. They're really only going to have one or two scriptures per, but you can go through and you can find it in your Bible. I want to encourage you to take a screenshot, take a photograph, take whatever you need to do, but check out these scriptures and find out how to overcome obstacles to healing. You know, one of the biggest obstacles to healing that's not on this list is the same obstacle that people face when it comes to hospitals. You know, the church is a hospital. The Bible says that the church is not a place for those that are well. It's a place for those who are sick. And you know, when somebody is too ashamed to go to the hospital, they cannot be healed by the staff at the hospital. They can't help you when you don't go there. And when we need help from heaven, we've got to go there. We've got to go into the presence of God. God can't help us until we come to God. So I want to encourage you today, if you've never come to Jesus, you've got to come to Jesus, because he wants to help you. The Bible says he is your ever-present help in time of need. All right, let's dig into some of these things. You guys ready? I hope you're feeling super encouraged already. Yeah. Well, the Bible tells us something in 2 Peter 3:9, but I want you to understand that God wants everyone to be healed. Amen. Healing is always the will of God. My goodness, and some of you might be out there and you're thinking, my experience is different because when I asked for healing, I didn't get healed. Your experience is wrong. because God's desire is for everyone to be healed. If that were not true, why would Jesus have healed every sickness and every disease? Why would Jesus have healed all? If God didn't want everybody to be healed, he wouldn't have healed everybody. You know what? The Bible tells us in 2 Peter 3:9, it tells us that it is God's desire that none should perish. And you know what disease and sickness is? It's just cells and systems and organs dying in our bodies. That's all that that is. It's a small form of death. It's some form of our body dying on the inside or on the outside or both. And God desires that none should perish, but that everyone would come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And by the way, he's not here just to save your soul. He's here to heal your body. God wants everyone to be healed. That means you. Whoever you are out there, and there's no condemnation. If you are having symptoms, if you're having sickness or disease in your body, I'm telling you, I'm so glad that you're listening to this message today, because God wants you to be healed. Healing is always the will of God, so ask him for it. How about this? God never teaches us through sickness. He teaches us through his word and through his spirit. You can find that in John chapter 16 and verse 3. See, God never teaches us through sickness. I've heard so many people, especially religious Christians. By the way, I hate religion. I am not in a church. I am not the pastor of a church to promote religion. I'm here to promote Jesus Christ, the lover of your soul, who will change your life forever. Religion kills and Jesus brings life. See, God teaches us through his spirit and his word, not through sickness. I've heard people tell me that, you know, I just had to go through this sickness because God was teaching me through it. Listen, you might have learned something through it, but that doesn't mean that God was using it as the tool. I mean, you might slam your finger in the door and learn to not slam your finger in the door. It doesn't mean it was a good thing for you. Like, you know, I don't teach my kids like that neither. Can you imagine if I tried to teach my kids, like, that the pot is hot on the stove, or that the stove burner is hot, so I take them over there and sear their hand on the burner on the stove to teach them, don't touch the stove? Can you imagine if I did that? I mean, CPS would be knocking down my door to take me away to the loony bin. And God is not a loony bin kind of a God. God is not a child abuser. God doesn't teach us through sickness. Now tell me this, right? If you had to teach your child something, would you teach them through sickness? Would you teach them, like, that you'll save them from drowning by letting them drown? No, you wouldn't do that. You know better than that. And if human fathers are good enough to not do that, our Heavenly Father is much better than that. I got to move along. Listen, the devil comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy, but Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. So if there's something destroying your life, Jesus came to destroy the destroyer's work. So if your life is being destroyed by sickness, Jesus came to destroy the sickness that's destroying your life. Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. If you've got all kinds of things going on in your life that the devil is wreaking havoc, stealing, killing, or destroying, look through your life, and any area where there is stealing, killing, or destroying in your life, invoke the presence of Jesus, because Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil, so that you have life and that you have it more abundantly. You should go look up these scriptures. By the way, I just got to tell you this, and it's not in the notes. God and the devil do not collaborate for your benefit. They don't work together. They don't get together and be like, you know, God's like, hey, look, like, I can't do this to them because, like, I'm God and stuff. So could you go down there and just like, Like, God doesn't work together with the devil for your benefit. The devil's trying to destroy you, and Jesus is destroying the works of the devil in your life. They are locked in a mortal battle for your soul, and they are not friends. They are not working together, and if you hate anyone, hate the devil. God is going to destroy the devil, by the way, in the end. Listen, Jesus healed those who were oppressed, listen to this, by the devil. You can find that in Acts chapter 10, verse 38. It said how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. My goodness, what would happen if God was with you? Oh, wait a minute, he is with me. Oh, that's awesome. Jesus healed all that were oppressed of the devil. See, they weren't oppressed by Jesus. They weren't oppressed by God. They weren't oppressed by the church. They were oppressed by the devil. Amen. And that's why Jesus destroyed that in their lives. Listen, every person Jesus healed was unsaved. So you can just get that one out of your mind that someone's got to get born again before they can get healed. Does it help them to get healed? Probably. But every person that Jesus ever ministered healing to, every person that all the disciples ministered healing to before Jesus ascended to the from the cross into the heavenly places, every one of them was unsaved. You know why? Because Jesus hadn't died and given salvation on the cross yet. So don't let that stop you. Even if someone is unsaved, pray for them. Get them healed, because that'll open their hearts to the healing love of Jesus Christ. Here's something that's so important, especially for you Christians out there. And when you understand faith and all that, yes, we need to walk by faith and not by sight. But here's the thing, is that we have to understand that our job is to be obedient, to lay hands on the sick. It is Jesus' job to heal the sick. You don't have the ability to heal the sick. You don't have the ability, nor do you have the responsibility to heal the sick. You have the ability and the responsibility to be obedient to God. Jesus has the ability and the responsibility to heal the sick. I want to take pressure off of you. There is no pressure for you to have results. All you need to do is have obedience. Amen. And when you're obedient, God will bring the results. Can I hear an amen to that? You know, God wants everyone to be saved, healed, and whole. God wants everyone to be saved, healed, and whole. And it's important that we understand that there is no one that God's like, nah, I don't want to give healing to that person. Nah, that one doesn't deserve it. No. God wants everyone to be saved and healed and whole. It's only us that wants, like, no, I don't want my mother-in-law to get to heaven. You know what I mean? Like, I'm not saying that for my mother-in-law. She's going to heaven already, so I'm glad that we have a good relationship. But here's the thing. Like, I don't want cats to go to heaven. I want them all to go to burn in hell. I'm just... Some people are like, oh, this is a mean church, you know? But God wants everyone to be saved and healed and whole. No matter how bad they are, God is after their heart. Yeah. Listen, not everyone will receive healing, just as not everyone will receive salvation. So don't let it mess you up. Like, this person didn't receive a healing, God must not love them, or God must not be good, or whatever. Don't let that mess you up. Not everyone's going to receive salvation either, but God wants everyone to be saved. Yeah. Just because God wants everyone to be saved doesn't mean that they're going to be saved. It's because they've got this thing called free will. See, God wants everyone to come to him, but not everyone is going to. You can look that up in Mark 16:16. See, I won't pretend to understand why some people don't get healed, or why they won't be healed, or why they don't want to be healed. I know there are some reasons. I know some good ones. It's because sometimes people want pity more than they want healing. Sometimes people want the disability check more than they want the ability to work. Sometimes people want to have attention more than they want freedom. But I know this for sure, that I'm convinced that any issue, any disconnect with healing is not a shortage on God's end. I'm certain of that, because salvation always works, and healing always works, and God always works. I want to give you one last one. Listen to this. You don't need a special gift or calling in order to have the sick be healed and recover when you lay your hands on them. The Bible says in Mark 16:17-18, the Bible says, and those who believe in my name, they shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. I just abbreviated that for you. Anyone who believes in his name. So that means you don't need to have the gift of healing. You don't have to have the gift of miracles. You don't have to even be filled with the Holy Ghost, although I suggest that you get it. Here's the thing. All you need to do is believe in the name of Jesus. How many of you guys are out there and you're believers? If you're a believer, you can just comment me raising my hand emoji. If you are a believer, healing is your portion. Healing is in your hands. Obedience is your portion. Obedience is in your hands. And if you would go and lay your hands on people, the sick would begin to recover. Well, Pastor Jake, what happens if I pray for 100 people and none of them get healed? Well, what if you pray for 100 people and one of them gets healed? What if you pray for 100 people and 100 of them get healed? I mean, if we want to play the what-if game, let's play the what-if game. See, why we got to be so negative all the time? Whatsoever things are good, whatsoever things are lovely, if there's any virtue, if there's any praise, think on these things. See, let's play the positivity game. What happens if everyone that you pray for gets healed? Oh my God, this world would be a healthy place, wouldn't it? I'd get my hands on anything that moves. I mean, I prayed for dogs, they've gotten healed. Legit. All right, listen, I want to give you some practical steps to praying for the sick because I feel like you're ready, like you're fired up. You're like, yes, turn me loose. Tell me how to do it. All I need to do is just wind me up and let me go. I want to set you up for success, so let me tell you how you do this. Here's the first thing. You want to be bold and compassionate. You can find this in Mark chapter 1 and verse 41, that Jesus was moved with compassion, or Jesus moved with compassion on people. When you're compassionate and you're bold, my goodness, so many good things take place. By the way, boldness means great plainness of speech. In other words, Don't stutter, stammer, and all kinds of things about, well, maybe Jesus might, whether it's his perfect will or his permissible will or No, just say it like it is. God wants you to be healed. I mean, if you look somebody in their beady little eyes and you tell them God wants you to be healed, and you say it with all the confidence of heaven because you know that's the truth, my goodness, people will just, oh, really? God wants me to be healed. Yes, God wants you to be healed. Let's get you healed. How about this? You give them faith through the word of God. Romans 10:17 tells us that faith comes by hearing, and hearing comes by the word of God. Listen, you don't have to give them chapter and verse. You just have to give them the word of God. The word of God is not the scripture address. The word of God is the word of God. It is what comes out of God's mouth. And it's important that when you give them faith through the word of God, see, you just tell them, God wants you to be healed. See, that's the word of God. Jesus healed everyone. That's the word of God. Yeah. When you tell them, when I lay my hands on the sick, they'll recover. That's the word of God. You don't have to give them the chapter and verse. Here's the next one. Lay your hands on the sick. Lay your hands on the sick. That is a practical step. Well, what if I don't want to touch them? Hey, look, I don't know what to do about that. The Bible says, lay your hands on the sick and they will recover. You know, I mean, here's a funny story. Legit, right? We were teaching some leaders about laying hands on the sick. And so someone had they felt like it was a very important question. They said, what if you don't have hands? Well, I don't know what you do. Lay your nub on them. You know, I mean, whatever you've got to do, you lay. I mean, Jesus sent his word. So you switch to another scripture. The Bible says that God sent his word and he healed them and delivered them from all their destruction. Jesus talked to the centurion and he told him, your servant is healed. Jesus sent his word out and the word accomplishes what it was sent to do. So I don't know, just switch over to that scripture, okay? But lay hands on the sick. If you've got hands, lay your hands on the sick and they will recover. I want to give you a few phrases that I like to use, and they may be bold, and they may be strong, and you might not feel comfortable saying them, but they are absolutely the truth. Listen, if I lay my hands on you, God will heal you, and you will recover. How do you know that? How can you say that? Well, because God said that. It's in Mark 16, 17, and 18. How about this one? When I lay my hands on you, you will begin to recover. See, you don't have to believe for the instantaneous miracle. You can believe the word of God that says that they will recover. That means to get better over time. How about this one? Hands are for blessing. If they're like, well, why do you want to touch me? See, when I prayed for my wife the first time when we met, and she had this raging, nasty migraine headache going on, I went up to her and I did exactly this. I said, if I lay my hands on you, God will heal you. And you know, because she needed Jesus, she thought to herself, he just wants to touch me. Which I did not. But I simply wanted to get my hands on her, and I needed to break down that thing. See, sometimes you can just tell somebody, hey, the only reason why is this, the Bible says to do it, and hands are for blessing. Can I just bless you? Hands are for blessing. And by the way, don't lay your hands on anything that starts with the letter B. You know? Don't lay your hands on anything that starts with the letter B. You want to make sure that, you know, shoulder, head, you know, something like that. Lay your hands on. And by the way, don't be like creeper, okay? Don't be like. Like, don't be doing any of that stuff. Just lay your hand on them and pray for them. Amen? Here's an important one, because sometimes when we get religious and we get nervous and everything, we think that we got to pray these big verbose prayers. I mean, people go back to the King James. They can't even speak proper English, and they're trying to speak King James English. Pray over them in pidgin. Pray over them in broken English or in your own language. It doesn't matter. God knows and God hears. It's not praying in the King James that gets people healed. Listen, longer prayers are not more powerful prayers. I like this prayer. Be healed in Jesus' name. Short, concise, to the point, clear. Be healed in the name of Jesus. That way they know when they get healed, who did it? Jesus did it. What are you expecting? You're expecting them to be healed. Be healed in Jesus' name. Right? It's not in my name, it's in Jesus' name. Longer prayers are not more powerful prayers. So don't pray for a long time, especially if someone's trying to get someplace. Just get it over, get your hands on them, lay your hands on the sick, and they will recover. So you have to understand and know the difference between praying for healing and praying to make people feel better. Yeah. Jesus was praying for people to feel better at the tomb of Lazarus. Oh, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me, that thou always hearest me, and that thou hearest me even now. And then he said, I'm praying these things so that these people over here know that you always hear me because you've always heard me. He didn't say he was praying for Lazarus. Lazarus was dead. He wasn't praying for himself. He had faith. He was praying for all the bystanders to understand what was going on. A longer prayer is not a more powerful prayer. I'm almost done with this sermon. You guys almost ready? You guys there? Here's the next thing. Here's the next practical point. Boldly speak to the issue or issues and tell it to stop, be healed, or to leave. The Bible tells us in Matthew 17:20, it tells us, if you say, if you declare with your mouth and you speak to the mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in your heart, but believe the things which you say shall come to pass. You shall have whatsoever you say. So you speak to that cancer, you speak to that growth, you speak to that headache, you speak to that eczema, you speak to that broken bone, and you tell it, be healed in the name of Jesus. You got to move out of the way. Cancer, shrivel up and die. Talk to that headache, go away from them in the name of Jesus. Heart arrhythmia, be healed in Jesus' name. You just begin to speak to it. Curvature in the back, scoliosis, straighten out in Jesus' name. Wow, Pastor Jake, that's pretty bold. Yeah, I'm righteous. I'm bold like a lion. And I'm going to eat my prey tonight in Jesus' name. Right? How about this one? Here's another practical thing. Use healing. And I think that's not my favorite way of saying it. But leverage it. It is a tool, it is a mechanism, it is an ability that God has put into our hands for evangelism. It is taking an invisible God and bringing him into the realm of the visible. It is something that is suspending the laws of natural living. And it is something that God is putting himself on display through his word and through his disciples. And you leverage it and you use it not to gain glory for yourself, but use healing from God as a means to tell the good news about Jesus's love and goodness. In other words, when you lay your hands on somebody, you say, be healed in Jesus' name, and all the pain in their back disappears immediately. They're like, how did you do that? What just happened there? Then you tell them, there's this guy, and his name is Jesus, and he loved you so much that he gave his life for you. See, when you get someone healed, they tend to listen to you. You know, I was in India not too long ago, and some people had heard that I was coming into town and that people were getting healed. And they literally, husband and wife, checked themselves out of the hospital, came walking down, IV still in their arm, came on down. Both of them were wrecked. I mean, I don't even know all the things that were wrong with them, but they had pain coursing through their bodies, literally still needles in their arms, and the doctors didn't know what was wrong with them. They could not get any better. They came to the meeting, and I looked at them, and I said, Jesus wants you to be healed. Do you believe this? They translated that, and they said, yes, we believe that. I laid my hands on them, and I said, in the name of Jesus, be healed, and guess what? They were. I'm telling you right now, they went back to that hospital, took the stuff out their arms, walked out the hospital completely and totally healed by the power of God. It wasn't me. It was just simply my obedience to number one, go, and number two, get these hands on some people's heads and get them healed by the power of God, because I believe that healing is for everyone. By the way, you know what? They didn't know Jesus. So you know what the next thing was that I did? I said, do you know who healed you? Jesus healed you. And Jesus wants to be in your life, not just to heal you, but to change your life forever. Would you like to know this Jesus that healed your body? They said, yes, we would like to know this Jesus that healed our body, that the doctors could not heal. I said, let me introduce you to my Jesus. And they're still in the church today. Amen. You see, you utilize the grace of God, the love of God, the healing power of God to open the door. See, the Bible says a man's gift makes room for him. God wants to put a gifting, a calling, a choosing, and the healing power of Almighty God at your disposal so you can preach to them the good news. What's the good news? You don't have to be sick anymore. What's the good news? You don't have to suffer anymore. What's the good news? There's someone that loves you enough to take your pain. What's the good news? The good news is there is someone that cares for you so deeply that he will take it so you can be free. I'm gonna land this plane. I wanna give you just one thing today, just one thing. Let's offer salvation to everyone we can. Amen. And let's offer healing to everyone we can. By the way, I want to just challenge you to a brand new level that just because someone is healed doesn't mean they should live sick. Just because they're healed doesn't mean that they should be broken down. Just because they're saved doesn't mean that they should be sick. Just because they're saved doesn't mean that they should live a broken down life. Just because they're saved doesn't mean that just because God's grace is sufficient for them that God wants them to suffer through sickness and disease. No, the grace of God is there to eliminate, to eradicate sickness and disease. You see, you gotta understand that one of the definitions of grace, and I'm getting off topic now, but one of the definitions of grace, because whoever you are out there and you're challenging my theology, one of the definitions of grace is this: the divine ability of God. So when God talked to Paul, when Paul had a thorn in the flesh, and we don't know what that thorn in the flesh was, but whatever it was, whether it was a physical ailment or a person that was a thorn in the flesh, you know, a pain in your neck, you know, that kind of a person, well, whatever that was, when he prayed three times and God answered, my grace is sufficient for you, he wasn't saying, Paul, suck it up. That's not what he was saying. God was saying, my divine ability is more than enough to take care of that issue. So whether you're sick, my divine ability is more than enough to heal you. Whether you've got an issue with people, my divine ability is more than enough to rectify the situation. My divine ability is more than enough and more than sufficient for what you need. I want to tell you, my friend, that God's grace is sufficient for you. If you've been saved and you're still sick, God wants you healed. He doesn't want you limping along to heaven. He wants you healed and whole, because that is the testimony of the love of God to have you completely whole. So I'm believing with you for miracles and for your healing. Be healed in Jesus' name. I want to give you one last scripture and I'm done. I love this scripture. In Isaiah chapter 6 and verse 8, it says this: "Also, I heard the voice of the Lord," and I pray right now that you would hear the voice of the Lord speaking to you. "I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?' Then I said, 'Here am I, send me.'" If you're bold enough right now, I want to ask you if you would say those very words: "Here am I, send me." See, God wants to send you into your world today, tomorrow, every weekday. He doesn't just want to send you to church. He wants to send you into your world. He wants to send you into your world with hands that are full of the healing power of God. God wants to send you into the world with compassion. God wants to send you into your world. And who shall we send? Don't send someone else, God. Here am I. Send me. I'll go. Who will go for us? I'll go, God. And I pray today that you make that decision in your heart and in your life, that everywhere that you go, that God is sending you to that place, into your school, into your workplace, into the supermarket, into the highways and the byways. As a friend of mine said it, you don't have to go around the globe. You don't have to go across the globe. Sometimes you just have to go across your street. And I pray today that we would be those that say, "Here am I, send me." Now today, if you don't know this wonderful Jesus that I've been talking about for the last while, I pray that you would get to know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, to exchange your unrighteousness for his righteousness, that you would exchange beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, and the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. I pray that you would trade out sin for sinlessness. The way that we do that is by receiving Jesus Christ and his great substitution for us. How do we do that? The Bible says you just need to do two things. The first one is that you believe that God raised Jesus from the dead. What good is Jesus if he's still buried in the ground with every other religious leader on the planet? No, Jesus is alive. Jesus is risen, and he's doing the same things today that he did in the Bible, healing every, healing all, and having great compassion. You have to believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead. The second thing that you need to do is you need to confess with your mouth that Jesus is the Lord of your life. What does that mean? That means that you're giving control of your life to him so that he'll lead you and you'll follow. Whatever he wants to do, you're going to follow with him. When he goes, you go. And when you go, he goes too. So today, if you can believe that God raised Jesus from the dead, and if you can also confess Jesus as the Lord of your life to follow him, you can be saved right here and right now. Over the next few seconds, next few moments, you can make that decision and become a child of God, with your destination being heaven and the power of God coming to dwell in your life so you can be a blessing to the world around you. If you'd like to do that right now, I'd like to lead you in a prayer. And this is not a magic prayer that saves you, but meaning it in your heart to God and saying it with your mouth is what makes all the difference in the world. So if you would like to pray this prayer with me today, right here and right now, if you've been away from Jesus and you need to come back home, you need to recommit your life to him, you can do that right here in this moment as well. When I pray, would you just repeat after me, and would you just mean it in your heart to the Lord, and let's come on home to Jesus. You guys ready? Let's pray. Everybody pray with me. Here we go. Just say this: "Dear God, I believe that you raised Jesus from the dead. I believe that Jesus is alive, and I receive his payment for me. I allow him to be my substitution. I give him my broken life, and I receive his perfect life. I want to declare with my mouth that Jesus is the Lord of my life, I'll follow him and I'll serve him. I'll do what he wants me to do and I'll be who he wants me to be. Because of these things, I know that I am now saved. I am a child of God and my destination is heaven. Thank you for saving me. I pray these things in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. My friends out there, if you prayed that prayer for the very first time or if you recommitted your life to Jesus, we want to ask you if you would reach out to us either via message or text or phone call or right here in the comment stream and just drop right in there, I got saved today, or I gave my life back to Jesus, or I recommitted my life. However you want to word it, we'll figure it out. We just want to rejoice with you because the Bible says that all of heaven is going bananas right now, knowing that you gave your life to Jesus. Not only that, but we want to send you a brand new Bible. We want to send you a gift you're absolutely going to love. And we want to tell you how you can take your next step in Jesus Christ. We promise we won't spam you, but we do want to ask you, don't let this be a one-off. So come and join us in person. Come back and join us online if you're not here on the island of Oahu. But come and join us again and learn how to live this life with Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. With that being said, we love you, we bless you, we speak the goodness of God into your life that you would experience it in the land of the living. We love you, we bless you, and we hope to see you again next week, Sunday at 10 a.m. The Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you. Be blessed the rest of your day.